In 1836, Ralph Waldo Emerson, leading figure in the American literature and transcendentalist movements, wrote an essay entitled Nature. In this essay, he called for an American poet who could see nature through American eyes rather than simply building the sepulchres of Europe. Why, he asks, should not we enjoy an original relation to the universe? And well, in walked Walt Whitman, sounding his barbaric yawp across the roofs of the world. And this barbaric yawp was bold and inclusive and sought to stitch this country together, much like Whitman would do during the Civil War, stitching our countrymen back together. Whitman was truly the first poetic voice of American democracy. In his poem, I Hear America Singing, Whitman uses the list poem form to show equality between all members of American society. And in using the conceit of singing, he reminds us that America is a chorus which requires many voices. I hear America singing. The varied carols I hear, those of mechanics, each one singing as it should be, blithe and strong. The carpenter singing his as he measures his plank or beam. The mason singing his as he makes ready for work or leaves off work. The boatman singing what belongs to him in his boat. The deckhand singing on the steamboat deck. The shoemaker singing as he sits on his bench. The hatmaker singing as he stands. The woodcutter's song. The plowboy's on his way in the morning or at noon, intermission or at sundown. The delicious singing of the mother or of the young wife at work or of the girl sewing and washing. Each singing what belongs to him or to her and to no one else. The day singing what belongs to the day. And at night, the party of young fellows, robust, friendly, singing with open mouths their strong and melodious songs.
Thank you.
Some years after 9/11, I'm sure most of us here will remember, there was a bunch of hoopla about a mosque at Ground Zero. Does anyone remember that? Except it wasn't exactly a mosque and it wasn't exactly at Ground Zero, but why did the truth get in the way of political posturing? Just so happens that there was two things happening at that time that I think produced this next piece. It's funny how things come together when you don't, when you least expect it. The first thing is I was listening to right-wing radio. And around this whole hoopla, what they were really saying is, who has the right to be an American? The language was, they did this to us. Who are they to think they can put this in our country? And I was like, wait a minute, that what's with that? You know, this country is lava that has yet to cool. Who are you to say exactly who gets to do what? And at that same time, I was talking to my oldest boy, Jordan, about one of the greatest songwriters our country has ever produced, which is Mr. Johnny Cash. And Mr. Johnny Cash has a song in which the protagonist is a gentleman who works at a Cadillac factory, but finds himself unable to afford to buy what it is he's actually putting together. Can you imagine that? Someone working in a place where they can't afford to buy what they're making? That would never happen. But it does happen. It does happen in this song. And so what he decides he's going to do, the gentleman, is that he's going to abscond, commandeer, he's going to steal him a car, and guess how he's going to do it? He's going to do it one piece at a time. So that's the name of the song, One Piece at a Time. And as the intersection between what I was hearing on the radio and what I was talking to my son about came together, I started thinking about this. And what he says is, over 20 years, he puts this car together. He steals a carburetor from here, he steals a muffler from there, and over 20 years, he puts this car together. He starts it up, and it starts up a little rough, and he's rolling it down the street. And people ask him, they're like, dude, what kind of car is that? And he goes, well, it's a 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56. He keeps on going for about 20 numbers. And I'm like, that's a lot like this country. Made up of all of these parts from different places. And it fits together. And as my grandmother would say, sometimes it's show enough ugly, right? But it stays on the road. So I guess this is for 315 members of this tribe, which is sort of moving towards something, though we're not quite sure what it is yet. And of course, whenever I'm in a quandary, I go to one of two of America's existential musics, one of course being blues and the other being country. So this is a country song, in the or a poem, however you want to say it, in the direction of Mr. Johnny Cash's One Piece at a Time. Well, I was at this one fancy coffee store behind a woman with looks I've never seen before, but she seemed to have much charm and style and grace. Well, she stepped to the counter and she ordered a drink. It was an iced cappuccino with soy, I think, but I was preoccupied in trying to surmise her race. You see, she wasn't quite white, she wasn't quite black, she wasn't quite this, and she wasn't quite that. In fact, I guess she wasn't quite anything, I suppose. Now, I didn't want to harass her or come off crass, but the question was burning, and I decided to ask, and she said, save your breath, I can guess what you want to know. See, everywhere I go, folks stare at me, trying to decode what I'm supposed to be. But truth is, mister, calculating me ain't so easy as you can see. So if you got the interest, I'll take the time and keep that question from smoking your mind. Just buy my coffee, and I'll tell you what I be. So I said, no sweat. That's a bet. I'm always curious to know what I don't know yet. And for me, that's worth a cup of joe or maybe even two. So I reached in my pocket, pulled out the money, paid for the coffee, and said, there you go, honey. Now sit down, girl, tell me. What in the world is you? Well, at that point, she took a deep breath. Well, a Jew, Italian, Haitian, Dominican, African-Asian, Mexico-Pian, Puerto Nigerio-Brazilian's what I am. And I'm meant to fit like a patchwork quilt, but from my sweat, this hit country's built. But keep it simple, stupid, call me American. Now you can just call me American, you can just call me American, though sometimes I ain't quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there are 300 million me's, red, white, and blue, and every in between. So we wrap after we about democracy, about what makes ours different than those ancient Greeks, we broach subjects most folks will tell you is taboo. We talked about love and religion and politics, about the Taliban and the Dixie Chicks, Democrats, Republicans, and them green rainbows too. We spoke about President Barack Obama, joked about Congress and all that drama, and wondered, is our economy really bouncing back? About whose fault it's going to be when our climate changes of trucks and such and good shooting ranges, and why I prefer a PC, but she likes a Mac. Yep, we yak so much we lost track of time, and though we're different, we began to find that she and I was quick-like becoming friends. And then she looked at her watch and said, gotta run, but thanks for the talk. I've enjoyed it, hun. Who can say maybe one day we'll see each other again? And as we both shook hands and said no more, she grabbed her purse and headed toward the door. This one, some dude looking real confused, comes over real slow. He's like, say, buddy, seem like you know that woman. You mind very much if I ask you something? I said, save your breath. I can guess what you want to know. And at that point, that's when I took a deep breath. And I said, Jew, Italian, Haitian, Dominican, African, Asian, Mexicopean, Puerto, Nigerian, Brazilian's what she am. And she's meant to fit like a patchwork quilt, and from her sweat as if country is built, but keep it simple, stupid, and call her American. So you can just call her American, you can just call her American, though sometimes she ain't quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there are 300 million she's, a red, white, and blue, and every in between. Now, you can just call us American, you can just call us American, though sometimes we ain't quite sure just what that means. But from sea to shining sea, there are 300 million we's, a red, white, and blue. And every in between. Down, 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 down. Thank you. Samuel Barber is without doubt one of the jewels in the crown of American composers. He is probably best known for his haunting Adagio for Strings, a composition I have never been able to listen to in its entirety without weeping. But he also has put many beautiful poems to beautiful music. One, his Nocturne, Opus 13, number 4, featuring the words of American poet Frederick Prokosh, you heard earlier in the program. Next, you will hear another Barber composition titled Sure on This Shining Night. The text of this piece is taken from the poem of the same name written by Mr. James Agee. Agee was a poet, novelist, journalist, screenwriter, and in the 1940s was one of America's most influential film critics. When Robert sings, Sure on This Shining Night, I am sure you will experience how Agee's powerfully imbued vivid visual imagery into this piece, and he's mixed it with a philosophical, almost Buddhist sensibility to render a poem of such tender transcendence. To me, it is a little wonder why Mr. Barber was attracted to his work. Sure, on this shining night.
Let's go.
Earlier in the program, Robert sang two poems by Langston Hughes that have been beautifully and powerfully set to song. I Too, which was set to song by Margaret Bonds, and Song to the Dark Virgin by Florence B. Price. Langston Hughes, as many here may know, was a leading figure in one of the most fruitful periods of American literature, the Harlem Renaissance. He was a tireless writer, one of my favorite personages in literary history. He wrote in all genres, fiction, poetry, song, libretto, and even translated works from Spanish. He translated the works of Nicolás Guillén of Cuba, and he translated Gabriela Mistral's work, who I believe was the first woman to win the Pulitzer, first woman of Latin American descent to win the Nobel Prize in Literature. What might be a bit lesser known about Hughes is how he would write. One part of his process was to go out and sit on the stoop of his apartment in Harlem, and he would close his eyes, and he would listen to the voices and cadences and conversations of people as they walked by his apartment. Hughes, like Whitman, a poet he loved, and studied, listened to America's singing. He did this so he could capture the essence of what those voices communicated, and he would then go into his apartment and he would begin writing from that music that he gathered. In his very musical lyric poem, Dream Variations, which I will recite, and after which Robert will sing, Hughes gives voice to a desire I suspect many of us harbor, to be free, to just be. To fling my arms wide in some place in the sun, to whirl and to dance till the white day is done, then to rest at cool evening beneath a tall tree, while night comes on gently, dark like me. That is my dream. To fling my arms wide in the face of the sun, to dance, to whirl, whirl, till the quick day is done, then to rest at pale evening. A tall, slim tree, night coming on tenderly, black like me. This next piece is excerpted from a longer piece. It is called Dear Dr. King, and is an epistolary or letter poem. This poetic form's roots can be traced back to the 17 BC, to the ancient Roman poet Ovid, and has been used by many great American poets, for instance, Robert Hayden's American Journal. The theme of brotherhood, which was central to King's message, places him squarely in the tradition of poets of the democratic impulse like Whitman and Hughes, for who among us could deny that King was a poet? Dear Dr. King was written for an MLK observation, which was held this past January. With it, I hope, like King, to remind my fellow Americans of how much better we could be to one another. And now, in this time of political and social sickness showing itself in our body politic, I feel we shouldn't have to wait for the next MLK observation to be reminded of this. Dear Dr. King, it's us again. Us yet again. And at this time, our nation finds it has come to a cross in the roads. Once again, we are being told that we should be violently afraid, goaded by fear that we have been made a second-rate nation, that our station was once great, and we can be great again. Dr. King, we are here today because we love this country dearly. Though we feel weighed down and sometimes get weary and sometimes forget what you and Gandhi and Whitman meant by a love of country that knows no limits. Dr. King, we need that music that played in you to play in our ears, to block out the insistent din we hear, the squawk of hawks seeking to mangle and strangle the better angels of our nature, those who intend to ignite the ethnic and religious hatreds you dreamed would end. Dr. King, we know you were not perfect. You were a flawed man in a long, long line of flawed men. But still, we need to find you, the best of you, within us now. Need your words to continue planting seeds somehow to help us communicate and create across and within this faltering space. To communicate and create as if we were all part of a centuries-long jazz song, a composition in which we are all musicians trying to blend our various multifarious additions into an evolving tune, a tune in which we sometimes serenely ride afloat in the spaces between notes, and at other times find we must musically muscle to make more room. And sometimes we scream. We scream because we don't know what to do with this song that we've let become so jangled and discordant for so long. So we've come here. Come here to learn how to keep on strumming, how to keep on drumming, how to keep on humming in search of that note that feels like a true one, like resolution. And when we find it, sometimes we find it is a blue one. We must never allow ourselves to become satisfied with unattained goals. We must meet physical force with the overwhelming force of the soul. I may not get there with you, but I want you all to understand that we as a people will get to the promised land. So, Dr. King, we have come here today on tired feet made of clay to both salve and sing our scars through our bloodthirsty mouths and blood-stained tongues in the midst of this present American darkness, but looking upwards, upwards, at a drinking gourd made of stars. Today, we sing, 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 Dr. King, like the instrument you've made us believe we are. Mm-hmm.
And the crooked places will be made straight, and the come ring from love.